welcome. It's my privilege and pleasure to introduce Johann Bergstrom Allen, who is a lay Carmelite from Britain and lives in York. And he is the editor of this wonderful book, which has become, in the English-speaking world, the formation book for lay Carmelites throughout the English-speaking world. And he has been invited by the lay Carmelites of Australia to a weekend in Mittagong, which is supposed to be a beautiful place, and I've never seen it, so I'll see it for the first time, to give a weekend to all of our priors and formators throughout all the lay Carmelites in Australia from all the states. So welcome, and we look forward to your presentation. Thank you.
I've been here for a week now, and I'm just picking up the lingo, but you'll have to tell me, can you say g'day in the evening?
Yeah.
Or is that just a morning
thing?
Anytime. Okay, so g'day. Right, I'm learning. Thank you very much for coming out this evening, and thank you to Damien and to Irene and to the Carmelite Centre here for the invitation to speak about Carmelite spirituality in a nutshell. That was the title I was given, but before I get on to that, I'm not very good with names, but maybe we could just quickly go around the room and share two pieces of information. Hopefully they won't be too difficult for you. The first is your name, and if you don't know it, look down and read the label. The second piece of information is one word that you associate with Carmelites. And you can be as honest as you like. So one word that you associate with Carmelites. So I'll start with myself. I'm Johann. And for me, the word I'd associate with Carmelites is family. And we'll come to go this way.
I'm Margaret. Spirituality.
Spirituality. Thank you, Margaret.
Hilaria. Knowledge.
Knowledge.
Felicity. And Teresa.
Teresa. Okay. Teresa of Lisieux or Teresa of Avila?
No.
Lisieux. Okay. Thank you, Christine.
Vilai. Intimacy.
Intimacy. Okay.
Clarice
and Teresa of Avila. Teresa of Avila. Thank you.
Damien, Brother Lawrence, the practice of the presence of now.
Okay. Thank you.
Angelina of the Santos. John of the Cross.
John of the Cross. Okay.
Sally, Serenity.
Serenity. Okay, I hope that's true. We'll see.
Brian, Inclusiveness.
Inclusiveness. Thank you, Brian.
Mary, friendship.
Friendship, important one, yeah.
Rob, John of the Cross.
John of the Cross, okay.
Charlie, contemplative prayer.
Contemplative, okay, thank you.
Linda, warmth and friendship.
Warmth and friendship, okay.
Catherine, contemplative.
Contemplative, thank you.
Yvonne,
activity.
Activity.
Okay, interesting, thank you.
John, Elijah.
Elijah, good one, yeah.
Richard, pause.
Pause. Not but rest. Yeah? Pause. Okay.
Mary, prayerfulness.
Prayerfulness.
Sarah, contemplative.
Contemplative. This is good. There's a good word coming out here. Yeah?
Carolyn, friendship.
Friendship.
Bartley, contemplation.
Contemplation.
Prayer. Keith, prayer.
Prayer.
I'm going to break the rule two things. Therese.
Uh-huh.
Contemplation.
Therese and contemplation. Well, Therese said I choose them all, so you can have more than one. That's fine.
Yeah. Irene, openness.
Openness.
I'm Donna and I have no idea what you're doing. I'm sorry. I'm
fine. Fine, that's what I said. Mystery.
Mystery. So we're fine.
Words we associate with Carmelite. So
oh, mystery. It
yeah.
Is.
To let me demystify or just add to the mystery? Yeah.
Fraternity.
Fraternity.
Yes.
And lady at the desk?
Reflection. Anne.
Anne, reflection. Okay, thank you. Well, I hope all those words will come up at some point this evening. But before I look at Carmelite spirituality in depth, when I was given this title, Spirituality in a Nutshell, I always associate that image of a nutshell with one particular person, and she's a woman long dead now, but she came from a part of the country I originally come from in England. She comes from the east of England, a city called Norwich, and her name is Julian of Norwich. So before I say anything about Carmelite spirituality, although she's not a Carmelite, we think there may be various links between her and the Carmelite order in medieval England. I just want to start having a pause, a reflective moment, to share some words from Julian of Norwich, her writings, her revelation, because I think it picks up some of the things that will come later. So I'll just take a quiet moment as I read this. God showed me a little thing the size of a hazelnut, lying in the palm of my hand, as it seemed. And it was as round as any ball. I looked upon it and thought, what may this be? And it was answered generally thus, it is all that is made. I marvelled how it might last, for I thought it might suddenly have fallen to nothing for littleness. And I was answered in my understanding, it lasts and ever shall, for God loves it. And so have all things their beginning by the love of God. In this little thing I saw three properties. The first is that God made it. The second, that God loves it. And the third, that God keeps it. But what is this to me? Truly, the creator, the keeper, the lover. For until I am substantially oned to God, I may never have full rest nor true bliss. God is true rest. God wishes to be known, and it pleases him that we should rest in him. I think she was a Carmelite nun ahead of her time. So I've been asked to say something for the next 45 minutes or so about Carmelite spirituality in a nutshell, and I'm going to try the impossible, which is to cram 800 years of history into just a short talk. Really, this is just an overview of the Carmelite journey. Some of you will be very familiar with Carmelite spirituality already. For some of you, maybe you don't know too much about the Carmelites at all. But I wanted to start with a picture that is on the cover of our book, Climbing the Mountain, because it speaks to me of two things in Carmelite spirituality. The mountain, and we'll see why that's an important image or metaphor for our spirituality a bit later. And you might just be able to make out the little figure here, climbing the mountain. And we often speak of the Carmelite journey into God as indeed a journey. A number of us were on the Carmelite Way pilgrimage last weekend. A great experience for me to get up into the Upper Yarra Valley. And that idea of journey, I think, is very fruitful for us. So, who are the Carmelites? Well, this is what they look like roughly 800 years ago. And they've weathered quite well. These are some fellow Carmelites from Britain. Basically, we're Christians of the Roman Catholic Church, but interestingly, we're attracting Christians of other denominations. We now have, for example, some Anglican Carmelite nuns. Within the church, we're a religious order. That's a family or a tradition of religious, by which I mean the friars like Father Jim or Brother Martino, and nuns, and then lay people as well, dating from about the year 1200, and we're still kicking around in Australia and in every continent around the world. And we heard from Julian of Norwich, God wants to be known. God wants us to know and to love him, to respond in relationship to him. And our spirituality, one of many different types of spirituality in the church, is a particular journey that hopefully helps us to spread the gospel, to spread the good news of God's love, and to make God better known and loved. Now, the fact that you're here means you've probably heard of Carmelites, but don't worry if you haven't, and don't worry if sometimes your image of Carmelites is a bit confused. If you've never heard of Carmelites before, you probably would link them with nuns. In fact, I was talking with Mary over supper this evening, Mary who works in the development office, and she said when she applied to work in the Carmelite Development Office, she thought she was applying to work with nuns. That's what the word Carmelite meant. She hasn't told me yet if she's disappointed or not. But in the public imagination, nuns are what people often associate with the word Carmelite. And that's interesting to me because they lived the most shut off, enclosed life of all the different vocations of the Carmelites, and they're the last branch of the Carmelite family to have developed. But they are now, thanks to, in particular, St. Teresa of Avila and Teresa of Lisieux, they are now probably the best known expression of Carmelite life. You might have heard of three of our superstar saints, three doctors of the church, that is, saints who have a particular teaching of relevance beyond their own particular area. And our three Carmelite doctors out of the now 35 doctors that we have in the church are Teresa of Avila, John of the Cross, and Teresa of Lisieux, each of them experts in prayer, in spiritual life, in the Christian way of following Jesus. You might have heard of Carmelites through some of our martyrs of the 20th century, and if you know any of these, one or two might surprise you. Edith Stein was a Jewish woman who became a Christian and later a Carmelite nun, and she wrote very beautiful philosophical writings, but because of her Jewish background, was martyred during the Second World War. Likewise, Titus Brandsma, a Dutch Carmelite friar, he's now Blessed Titus, he was very outspoken in Holland in the 1940s in saying, you cannot be a Christian and follow fascist ideology. You can't follow Jesus and Hitler. You have to make a choice. And for that, he too was incarcerated and killed. Isidore Bakanja was a young man in the Congo in the 1920s, working on a plantation. He wore something called the Carmelite brown scapular. This is a larger version of what he's wearing. It's a cloth that is a miniature version of the order's habit. And he refused to take it off when his plantation worker owner demanded that he do so, and for that he was beaten and later died. And another man who you may not associate with Carmel, but Oscar Romero, who many of us hope will be beatified sometime soon. Oscar Romero was the Archbishop of El Salvador. In 1980 he was shot by a government assassin because of his outspoken defence of the poor. And he was shot while celebrating Mass in a Carmelite chapel. He lived with Carmelites, with Carmelite sisters in the capital of El Salvador, and he had a great love of Our Lady of Mount Carmel, that particular devotion. And many people, when they think of Carmelites, don't associate the order with martyrdom, but actually it's a very fruitful part of our history. Today we're celebrating the Feast of All Carmelite Saints, and the martyrs are very important for us. You might have come across Carmelites through some well-known pieces of artwork. Does anyone know who this chap is? Infant of Prague, yeah. I know you've got statues of him in both the churches here, St. Joseph's and Our Lady's. This is Prague in the background here. This is a devotion associated with the discount Carmelite friars in Prague, meant to encourage reflection on Christ's kingship and on his innocence and the other virtues that go with childhood. This very haunting image is of Adam and Eve being expelled from the Garden of Eden after the fall, and it's in a Carmelite church in Florence, the Carmine. Well worth seeing if you ever get a chance. And this image here on the end is by Salvador Dali, you know, the guy who did the paintings with the melting clocks and all those weird images. Well, this is a painting he made based on a sketch that St. John of the Cross had of the crucifixion seen from the perspective of God the Father looking down on his Son. So these are fairly well-known Carmelite images. And as I say, the scapula, which basically comes from the Latin for a shoulder, because it goes over the shoulders like this, the scapula is worn probably by millions of people around the world. Many people wear it without knowing that its origins are in the Carmelite order. Here we have a friar who is wearing the full habit, and he's enrolling these lay people in the scapula, the miniature scapula, as a sign of identifying with Carmelite values, particularly devotion to Mary, and putting on her habit. You might have heard of Carmelites thanks to some very nice things that have been said about us over the years. Thomas Merton, who I'm sure many of you will have heard of, a Cistercian monk, said that all Christians owe something to Carmel. It's a big claim, but basically he was saying that Carmelite writers, Carmelite saints over the centuries have had such a profound impact on our understanding of the church, of prayer in particular, that all Christians, whether they know it or not, have a debt to Carmel, which is rather nice. Blessed Pope John Paul II, praying here in front of a statue of Our Lady Mount Carmel, He described Carmel as a place where prayer becomes life, and life flourishes in prayer. For us, those two things are interwoven, prayer, life, life, prayer, and ideally, the two are not ever separated. The current Holy Father, Benedict XVI, he's here meeting our Prior General Fernando, said in a letter to the Order that Carmelite communities are authentic schools of prayer. In these schools, hearts fall in love. Sounds a bit like an advert for a dating agency, but I think it's a very beautiful image that in Carmelite communities, we teach prayer, we teach people how to fall in love with God. And you may know some famous Carmelite phrases. Probably the most famous is the Dark Night of the Soul. This has passed into popular culture. You'll be pleased to know that part of my early formation back in the UK was watching Neighbours. And I'm sure that at some point over the last few years, someone on Neighbours has said, I'm having a real dark night of the soul. I'm having a really tough time. But usually when people quote this, they don't really know the full context. And it comes from the writings of St. John of the Cross. And it describes a time that he says is a very natural, even necessary part of spiritual growth. There comes a time when maybe we've been praying for a while, maybe we've been raised as churchgoers, when God seems to be absent, when we have doubts, we have darkness, and we wonder whether God even exists at all. And there are two temptations at that point. One is to walk away from faith and give it up, say, no, there is no God. The other is to redouble our efforts, to pray twice as hard, to do twice as much, and that won't work either. John says what's happening in that process is that God is actually drawing closest to us than we've ever known before. And God's brilliance is so bright that it's like putting on sunglasses. I'm not used to the beautiful sunshine that you have here in Melbourne, so I've been walking around with my sunglasses on to protect my eyes from the brilliance. The same happens in the dark night. God, if you like, puts on those sunglasses because he's coming closer and closer, and for our protection, so that we're not overwhelmed. It seems like a period of darkness, but in that time, great graces can occur. We heard someone mention the practice of the presence of God. Damien mentioned it. That's another phrase you may have heard of. Again, associated with the Carmelites, particularly Brother Lawrence of the Resurrection, a French discalced Carmelite, a Carmelite friar, who said that his practice, his prayer, was to try and see God's presence everywhere. He famously talked about a tree that in the autumn lost its leaves, but he knew that in the spring new life would come. And so he saw God in even images and places that seemed difficult and dark. He talked about finding God as much in the kitchen or in the stables as in the chapel. And he really wrote some beautiful writings that helped people to grow this practice of the presence of God inside themselves. Similar to that, St. Teresa said, find God amid the pots and pans. My mum likes this one particularly. She's the one who cooks in my parents' house, and often when she can't be saying prayers in the usual way, she knows that she can find God amid the pots and pans. This is another phrase of John of the Cross, where love is lacking, put in love, and you will draw out the love. I find that very challenging. I've been in situations, as I'm sure have you, where maybe there's a tension in a family or a workplace, love really seems to have gone out the door. And John says the challenge is not to think that there is no love, but to put in love, and you will discover that the love you thought wasn't there actually was there, and you'll draw it out. It takes a lot of trust to do that. St. Teresa said, let nothing disturb you, nothing affright you, all things are passing, God never changes. This is famous because it's on a number of bookmarks, and the reason it's on bookmarks is because the first recorded version of it was on a bookmark that was in her breviary. And finally, thinking about journeys and the Carmelite journey, St. Teresa, travelling around Spain, often went by horse and cart. And on one particular journey, her horse and cart got dislodged in the river, and her journey was completely head over heels, turned over, problems. And she turned to God and said, I'm trying to do your work. Why is it that this has happened? And she said that she felt inside herself God say, well, that's sometimes how I treat my friends. To which she responded, well, if that's how you treat your friends, it's no wonder you have so few of them. And I like that little phrase because Teresa, I think, shows us how to be honest in prayer, how to talk to God, as she says, to a friend on a regular basis. And we don't have to dress up our prayer and our conversation with God. So today, in a structural sense, the Carmelite order, the Carmelite family, we talk about it being a community of communities. And I suppose the basic three levels are you'd have a local community, like a priory here, or a monastery of nuns, or a lay group. They would be organised in a province. Here we're in the province of Australia and Timor-Leste. I come from the British province. And together, those provinces make an international family that's present all around the world. We're somewhat independent of bishops, but obviously work very closely in collaboration with them. We're available to go where we're needed, basically. We're not tied to one particular place. And a number of friars are serving the church as bishops. Now, I'm going to show you four branches of Carmelite life that exist in Britain. I know three of them exist in Australia. I think one of them doesn't. The Carmelite nuns, enclosed, they don't go out very much. They live a cloistered life. In Britain, we also have Carmelite sisters, and they are apostolic. That is, they go out and about, work in parishes, hospitals, prisons. I don't think you have any Carmelite sisters in Australia, no?
East Timor.
Okay. We have Carmelite friars and lay Carmelites. The Carmelite friars, some of them are ordained priests, some of them aren't. The lay Carmelites, well, that covers a huge range of people. People who are in what we call the third order, such as myself, people who've taken promises of poverty, chastity, and obedience, like the friars and the nuns, but according to our state in life. So I've taken those promises, my mother has taken those promises. We also have people who are linked to us through wearing the scapula. We have people who are linked to us through parishes. It's the biggest group that there is in what we call the Carmelite family. So, to summarise in just a sentence what a Carmelite is, Carmelites seek to be contemplatives, maybe come back to that word later, who form praying communities at the service of all God's people. And I've underlined prayer, community, and service because we speak of those being our three core elements of our charism, our way of life, taking particular inspiration from Mary and Elijah, and I'll come to them a bit later on. They're our patrons. There are special models. Put short, we're trying to be friends of God and God's people. Sometimes we succeed. Another way to put it is a Christian who follows Jesus by living the Carmelite way of life, following the Carmelite journey, because we're responding to an extraordinary love, the love of God. And if it isn't about the love of God, well, we may as well give up. If it doesn't come down to this in the end, why would you settle for less? This is what it's all about. And I never know how to illustrate the love of God, but I think beauty is a great way of perceiving God's presence. And the other day, I was walking along Middle Park Beach, and I really thought, God might actually be here quite regularly. It's such a beautiful spot. I really enjoyed it. I've got a fairly long quote here, but I think it's very relevant because we talk about beauty, we talk about love, but one of the things that attracted me to the Carmelites was their vocabulary that struck me as very honest. We had Teresa of Avila arguing with God. We have John of the Cross talking about the dark night. And we began with a quote from Julian of Norwich, who said, "I'm never going to rest until I rest in God." And of course, she's referring back to St. Augustine and others who have that sense too. And I think the search, the journey, the quest is very much at the heart of what Carmelites are about. And a modern Carmelite friar in the States, Father Jack Welsh, says this: "The Carmelite tradition begins in searching hearts. Where have you hidden, beloved?" writes the Carmelite poet and mystic John of the Cross. "You fled like a stag after wounding me." We fragile humans have an aching heart, a hunger, a desire which we seek to nourish and fulfill. We have a vague idea that somehow God is the answer to our longing. At least we have been told so, and we want to believe. But who is this God? Where is this God? Those who are drawn by the Carmelite tradition are often pilgrims to places unknown, trusting the testimony of others who have taken the same ancient path. I was saying on Friday last when I was walking on the Carmelite pilgrimage that I didn't know the way, and I had to follow the people in front of me who knew where they were going. And I think in Carmel, what I found is a very deep sense that I'm following people who aren't perfect. They have a hunger, they have a need, there are things missing in their lives, but they're drawn to God. And I think by following them, I'm following authentic guides who are being led into this love of God. So, the order takes its name from Mount Carmel. The Carmelites, a lot of religious orders are named after a particular founder, we're named after a place. And that place is Mount Carmel in the Holy Land, northern Israel, here. Has anyone been to Mount Carmel? Jim? Yeah, I've never been. Perhaps next time I come to Melbourne, we can all go on from there to Mount Carmel. This is Mount Carmel. It's slightly deceptive, the picture we put on the book, because there's a great big tall mountain. It's actually a rather gentle slope, jutting out into the Mediterranean. And it was here that a group of hermits gathered, sometime around the year 1200. And Mount Carmel was significant, because it's a place associated with holy people. And I want to start with Jesus, because Carmelite life is all about Jesus. We're a Marian order, but true devotion to Mary always points us to Christ. And although Jesus, as far as we know from the scriptures, never went to Mount Carmel, there's an ancient tradition that Mary took him there as a boy. And as Christians, we believe that Jesus of Nazareth, is the revelation of God the Father. He's been sent by God to tell us the good news that we are loved. And we encounter this person of Jesus, particularly in the scriptures, in prayer, and in other people. So I want to make him the focus. But in particular, Mount Carmel is also associated with this guy, Elijah. Elijah was a prophet. We read about him in the first book of Kings. A man of action and prayer. A very dynamic figure. If you read 1 Kings 17 onwards, he does all sorts of amazing things. And I don't know of any other religious order in the church that has such a level of devotion to a figure from the Old or the First Testament. There may be, but I've not come across them. He's really a fascinating figure. And particularly important for us as Carmelites is an episode that took place on Mount Carmel with Elijah. You probably know the story. Israel had been corrupted by the worship of false gods. The people of the covenant had broken the covenant because King Ahab and his wife Jezebel had imported the worship of false gods into the land of Israel. And Elijah is sent on this mission to call the people of Israel back to the worship of the one true God. So he has a competition with the prophets of Baal, this false god. There are 450 of them, let's say on this side of the room. They construct an altar, and Elijah over this side of the room, he constructs an altar, and he says, right, we're going to have a shouting contest. I'm going to call on Yahweh, the God of Israel, and you call on on Baal, and we'll see which God wins. And lo and behold, as we see in this ceramic, fire falls down on Elijah's sacrifice and vindicates the one true God of Israel. And I think that episode has left Carmelites with a very fundamental question. In which God will we place our trust? Which side of the room are we going to choose? Which sacrifice are we going to make? Because we don't have Baal worship so much these days, but we certainly have a lot of false idols. TV, money, sex, drugs, rock and roll, all the fun things. Careers, esteem. These are all things that we can feed off and worship, thinking that they will make us happy, that they will feed that hunger, that aching that we have. And it's a lifelong struggle, I'm finding, to turn away from those things which we think will make us happy and cling to the one true God of Israel, the one who, as Julian of Norwich said, is the only one who can give us rest. And it's not easy. If it was, we'd all be doing it. But that challenge to us to choose whether we will root for the one true God or not is at the very basis of Carmelite life. Now, Elijah had another encounter with God that wasn't just about fire falling from heaven, but that powerful moment that prophetic moment, I think, does inspire Carmelites. He was often out doing great deeds, great actions, particularly for the poor, for the marginalised. We just had recently in our Sunday readings his encounter with the widow at Zarephath, and looking out for the poor, looking out for the marginalised. And so he inspires Carmelites, I think, particularly in work for justice and peace and to protect the integrity of creation. He's someone who shows us that our faith and our daily life are linked. You can't say, well, I'm just going to do the spiritual bits and daily life is something else. But as I say, he had this other encounter, beautifully depicted in a sculpture at Donvale. I was there just a couple of days ago at Whitefriars College, and here there's a new statue of Elijah. He's dropped his sword here, he's closed his eyes, and he is open. His hands are opening to the presence of God. Because we read in 1 Kings 19 how he went to Mount Horeb, fleeing from Jezebel, who was out to get vengeance for what he'd done on Mount Carmel. And there was an earthquake, there was a fire, there was a wind. And it says in the scriptures, God wasn't in any of those things. But then, depending on your translation, there was a sound of sheer silence, or a gentle breeze. Some translations say a thin nothingness. And in that, Elijah drops his sword, he covers his face with his cloak out of respect, because he knows that God is present there, in nothingness, in silence, in stillness. And ever since looking back to Elijah, Carmelites have said, we find God in action, we find him in the fiery prophetic side of life, but we also find God in silence, in stillness, in nothingness. So often in Carmelite communities, you will find a great emphasis on silent prayer, on simply taking some space out and having a pause, as we heard earlier, to be in God's presence. The other great figure of inspiration for Carmelites alongside Elijah is Mary, Miriam of Nazareth. And as mother of Jesus, mother of God, she's someone who leads us on that journey to follow Jesus. She's a reliable pointer. She was his first teacher and his first disciple. And by following in her footsteps, we are led to Christ. And there's a beautiful statue, I'm sure you all know it, just next door. I was photographing it yesterday, of Our Lady, depicted as Our Lady of Mount Carmel. Carmelites have a number of titles for Mary. Mary of Carmel, Mother, that's fairly standard, Queen, Patron of our order, Beauty of Carmel, and my favourite is Sister. I have a little sister. We fought like cat and dog when we were small, but we are very close, and I love my sister very much, and I know she loves me, and I like talking about Mary as my sister. And we do that because in the Middle Ages, the official name of the order was the Brothers of the Blessed Virgin Mary of Mount Carmel. And the Carmelites said, well, hang on, if we are the Brothers of the Blessed Virgin Mary of Mount Carmel, she's our sister. And the other religious orders said, no, you can't say that. Mary's not your sister. But it's something that we've clung to right from the earliest days of the order, that Mary is our mother, our beauty, our patron, but also our sister. And rather than saying, well, we're dragging her down to our level, I think it raises us up to the potential that we have to be the brothers and sisters of Jesus Christ. She was a contemplative Jewish woman. She pondered God's word. And in that, I think she shows us also to be attentive to the scriptures, which is something else I'll come back to. The Bible often refers to Carmel as a place of beauty. We read in the Song of Solomon, your head crowns you like Carmel. And it's a place where God's people often encounter God. And the word Carmel itself means a garden or an orchard or a vineyard. We don't have many vineyards in England, but I look forward to going to Mittagong in a couple of days where I gather there's lots of vineyards. And by a well, a spring, the fountain of Elijah, on Mount Carmel, a place called the Wadi Ain Nesia, those first hermits gathered to form a community. You've got the sea on one side, desert on the other, and the hermits gathering in this valley. And we don't know much about them. They were probably pilgrims to the Holy Land or crusaders who'd gone to fight to reclaim the Holy Land and the holy places for Christianity. But for some reason, they turned away from war, they turned away from that exterior conflict and, if you like, focused on an interior battle, that fight that we all have with those false gods that I spoke about. And they offered hospitality to passing pilgrims. That's how we know the first reference is pilgrims to Jerusalem tell us about these hermits that they met. And this is the ruins of the first oratory, the first chapel that's still there on Mount Carmel today. And we have this idea of hermits as being people who are out on their own, not often interacting with people. Well, there is an element of that, certainly, but the medieval idea of a hermit was also someone who did that for a while, but came together for protection, for support, and so on. So we have in this Italian medieval painting, you might just be able to make out various hermits in caves and ravines on Mount Carmel, gathering around this well of Elijah. And we talk about Carmelites today being solitaries in community. That sounds like a paradox, but very important in the Carmelite journey is to spend some time in the cell, the cave, and some time in community. Now, we don't normally have caves or cells these days. We have, well, I've got a nice ensuite room whilst I'm here. It's very, very comfortable. But the cell of the heart, that space where I'm alone with God. Jesus said, go into a secret place and talk to your Father in secret. He also said, you know, mix with other people. We need those two parts of life. And St. Basil the Great, an early father of the church, said, if I live alone and Jesus wants me to wash the feet of other people, how do I do that? Whose feet do I wash? So Carmelites blend those two elements of solitude and community. Now those hermits, after a while, seem to have needed a kind of set of guidelines, some sort of documentation that would spell out their way of living together. We'd probably call it a vision statement today. And I'm pleased to say that it's the shortest vision statement, the shortest religious rule in the church. So short that it fits on just two sides of paper. And I'm just going to circulate some copies. And it's called the Rule of St. Albert because the hermits that we see in this painting coming off from Mount Carmel went to Albert, who was the Bishop of Jerusalem, the Latin Patriarch, and they asked him for a way of life, something that would guide how they would live together. And in this very short document, we have over 100 scriptural quotations and allusions. It is drenched in scripture, and that's significant. And it gives very little specific guidance on daily life. There are some things that it talks about, but it's more the spirit of how Carmelites are to live. And I think that's why it's inspired so many people, because it's very adaptable and very flexible. This is a medieval copy of it in Avila in Spain, and here are just a few key features. I won't go through the whole text, but it encourages Carmelites to have a relationship profoundly open to God through pondering the scriptures, to live as brothers, full of charity with an elected leader, to meditate day and night on the law of the Lord, which we normally interpret as meaning the person of Christ and the scriptures, to pray together and alone several times a day, especially the Psalms, to celebrate the Eucharist daily when possible, to do work of some kind, as St. Paul said, and to take Paul as a particular model and teacher, to live in poverty and simplicity, sharing what little you may have, to love the church and all people, to engage in spiritual warfare with the devil, no longer fighting other people who you think have no right to be where you are, but engaging in that inner battle, and seeking the will of God together through community discernment. So those are some of the key features, and there are plenty of others. People discuss what's at the heart of the rule. Well, for me, particularly important is chapter 3, which says that we are called to live a life of allegiance to Jesus Christ, pure in heart and stout in conscience. As I said, it's all about Jesus. We're constantly pointed back to Jesus by the rule. And chapter 10, as I say, each one of you is to stay in his or her, we would say today, own cell or nearby, pondering the Lord's law day and night and keeping watch at prayers, unless attending to some other duty. There's lots of let-out clauses in this rule. Unless you've got something else to do, or if it's possible, or normally. It's very flexible. And there's a very clear allusion in this text to the first Christian community in Jerusalem. That's the model, I think, that Albert, the Bishop of Jerusalem, is working from when he compiles this document. We read in the book of Acts, the first Christians devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to fellowship, to the breaking of bread and to the prayers. All who believed were together and had all things in common. They would sell their possessions and goods and distribute the proceeds to all as any had need. That's what we're invited to aspire to. And Albert's rule, written 800 years ago, is interpreted today by various documents, constitutions for the friars, the nuns, and the lay people, which, if you like, says something about aspects which Albert never talked about. You know, what are you going to do about websites? Albert doesn't refer to websites. So we have documents that talk about our libraries and so on and so forth. And in the constitutions, over 800 years of reflection, the latest set of friars' constitutions have summarised the charism of the order, that is, the particular gifts that the Holy Spirit has given the order for the service of the church and the world, like this. Carmelites form praying communities at the service of all God's people, taking particular inspiration from Mary and Elijah. By combining these key elements, we seek to be open to God's grace of contemplation. So for us, all these three elements are part of a contemplative living. We often talk about contemplative prayer, but we also talk about contemplative service and contemplative community. What is contemplation in our understanding? Well, I won't go into this for very long, but as I say, it's not simply prayer or being quiet and meditative. Contemplation in a Carmelite understanding is the inpouring of God's grace. It's friendship with God that leads to divine union. And it's a gift. God gives it when God wants. It's not something we can earn or demand, but we can make ourselves more open to receive it through prayer, community building, and service. I'm going to skip this slide. Just very quickly to say, how do we know if someone or something is contemplative? Well, we don't, because it's God's gift. So when we talk about contemplative prayer, as I say, we also talk about contemplative community and service, because those three elements are combined. And we often talk about the nuns as being contemplatives. Well, yes, hopefully, but no more necessarily than the lay Carmelites out and about in the world. And we can judge if someone is open to this friendship of God through whether or not they love. Jesus says, by their fruits you will know them. If someone is coming closer to God, if someone is opened up to God's friendship, then we'll see it in the way that they are more like God, and God is love. So the Carmelite family, inspired by Elijah and Mary, we have a rather nifty little crest. You'll have seen it on various documents and posters and things. We're not quite sure what it means, but the general consensus is that it's a mountain depicting Mount Carmel with three stars that maybe stand for Mary, Elijah, Elisha. Some people say Jesus, Mary, and Elijah. I personally think it's Jesus the mountain. We have a lot of references in our tradition to Jesus as the mountain. Mary, Elijah, and this star here, that's us ascending the mountain, climbing the mountain. Who knows? None of us is sure, but it's something to reflect on. And the motto, Zelo Zelatus Sum Pro Domino Deo Exercitum, I am filled with zealous zeal. I'm really zealous for the Lord God of hosts. It's a quotation of Elijah, and we see his fiery sword and the crown of Mary. As I said, the first hermits couldn't stay on Mount Carmel. They were engaged in this physical warfare, turned to spiritual warfare, but the Crusades were ongoing. And eventually those Crusades got so difficult that the hermits had to leave and return to the places they had probably come from in Europe. And they came to England very early, which is nice for me, living in England. They came to the north, to a place called Holme, and to the south, a place called Aylesford, which is still really important for the Carmelite order internationally, because it was at Aylesford in 1247 that the first general chapter of the order happened. That is the first meeting of all the hermits. And they made a radical decision in 1247 that was to change the whole course of Carmelite history. Instead of being hermits who could rely on the donations of passing pilgrims and being able to take fruit off the trees growing in the Mediterranean, well, the north of England, let me tell you, having left the north of England a week ago, minus one and frost, it's not so good for hermits as the beautiful weather you would have here or would have in the Holy Land. And they were literally starving. They couldn't live as hermits anymore. They also found that back in England and in France and in Italy, towns were growing, exploding massively in the 1200s, and there was this new movement, these people called Franciscans and Dominicans, who were going into the towns and preaching to the people and responding to their needs. So the hermits decided to stop being hermits and to become mendicant friars. That is the Latin, basically, for begging brothers. Now, what's significant about becoming a friar? Well, they live in the heart of society. If you think of religious life in Europe at this time, many religious communities were big monasteries out in the hills, where they had land, they had income from sheep and so on, and somewhat cut off. Well, the friars were going to be right in the towns, and often on the edges of the towns where there were a lot of social problems. The friars lived as equals. There wasn't an abbot who was in charge. An abbot is a father, abba, father. They weren't to have that, they were to have a prior. And a prior is the first among equals, but an equal with the rest. They were to share with people their experience of God. We get in a famous phrase, to be contemplative and to share the fruits of that contemplation with others. So really responding to that hunger that people feel. They served the people that they lived with practical apostolates. Here in Australia, you have schools, you have parishes. Over the years, the order in different places has hospitals and clinics and all sorts of programs. So a very practical outreach. And finally, we have this flying friar. I'm going to make you do that again. Woo! Friars and mendicants. They're beggars who choose poverty and simplicity. They choose not to be rich and to rely on what is given to them, to rely on the providence of God. And as I say, that's quite different from the monastic model at that time. And this model of life was very attractive. We have early figures like St. Simon Stock, who drew people by their holiness. And within a very short space of time, the Carmelite order just exploded across Europe. So forgive me for focusing on Britain, but that's what I know. Here, Britain and Ireland, a huge number of communities before the Reformation. Over 40 in England alone, and a similar number in Ireland from where eventually, of course, the Carmelites came to Australia. And the friars attracted other people. The first hermits on Mount Carmel had almost certainly been lay people. We know that because there's a reference to celebrating the Eucharist when possible, which probably implies that there wasn't a priest there. They were almost certainly a lay community. And lay people have always been drawn to Carmelite spirituality from the very earliest ages, and that includes when the hermits became friars. Because this is a group in modern-day Rome. They're not friars, they're laymen, wearing a miniature version of the order's brown and white habits and the scapular. Brotherhoods, confraternities have always associated with the friars for a long time. There's a window at the church here, overlooking the entrance, that is erected by a confraternity that was here in the parish at Wright Street over 100 years ago. We know that women, in particular, wanted to associate with the Carmelites, women possibly like Julian of Norwich, who wanted some sort of life of prayer, possibly coming together in small communities like the Beguines or the Anchorites, and they were veiled in the Carmelite habit. This is a very early image of what would later become Carmelite nuns. The nuns formally developed in the 1400s. This is a community in York where I'm based, and some centuries after that, we got active sisters because the church was very suspicious initially of women not being enclosed, not being, you know, kept under control in a building without and about. People like Mary MacKillop, you know. And then lay Carmelites. We began to be formally organised from the 1600s. This is a group in Britain today. And you'll find lay Carmelites all around the world. Now, having said how popular the order was, I'm not saying that the order was perfect or that the medieval church was perfect. At the Reformation in England and in Europe, or parts of Europe, the order was suppressed. It was banned. And this is part of York Castle, where we know the last Carmelite friar from the medieval period was imprisoned. And the order itself underwent a period of reform and renewal. St. Teresa of Avila and her great friend John of the Cross wanted to go back to the simplicity of the rule of St. Albert. They said Carmelite life had become too complicated, the communities had become too big, and they wanted something going back to what they understood to be the origins of the order. And so we get the discalced observance. Discalced literally means without shoes. They wore sandals rather than shoes with uppers. And then I'm going to skip a long bit of history, but in the 19th century, the Carmelite order returned to England, eventually coming back to Aylesford. This is where that first general chapter happened, and this is a painting of the friars coming back. And here in Australia, James Dempsey and John Butler were two people transported from Ireland, convicts, who were members of some sort of Carmelite confraternity, a brotherhood. They were pioneers, really, of the church here in Australia. They helped to build St. Mary's Cathedral in Sydney. They provided an outreach to the Catholic community when for 10 years, more or less, there was no Catholic priest in the country. So the origins of Carmel in Australia are also with lay people. And today, we're a very diverse bunch. This is my community that meets once a month up in York. We have friars, nuns, sisters and lay people all coming together. This was me with Jim and with Keith. We went to meet the nuns at Kew Carmel just the other day. Had a fantastic encounter with them. And at the weekend I met with the lay Carmelites in Melbourne here in this room. So lay Carmelite life is still thriving. The friars are still thriving. The nuns and the sisters are still thriving. And we're all over the place. And it's hard to spot us in a crowd, you know. those of us who wear habits, maybe a little easier, but you could be walking past a lay Carmelite almost anywhere. I'm going to quickly rattle through what Carmelites do in Britain today, because I don't know so much. I'm finding out on this trip what Carmelites in Australia do. But this is just a little bit of what we do. We have a big parish in Britain in South London, very diverse, more than 100 different nationalities there. And the parish priest is Father Kevin Melody, who some of you may know because he was here for a few months and in Timor. This is Kevin working in our parish. We also have friars working in prisons as chaplains in Belmarsh, for example. We have friars and lay Carmelites working in media, broadcasting, publishing, giving retreats and spiritual direction. This is Aylesford Priory, beautiful place in southern England. Teaching and research, we have an online distance course that is operated also from here at the Carmelite Centre, Carmelite Institute of Britain and Ireland. And this is the university chaplaincy in York, where I'm based, where we get hundreds of young people getting involved in the life of the church and Carmelites involved in that ministry. I suppose in all these ministries, we're trying to promote that encounter with God, that response to the hunger we all feel, that need for God in our hearts. And that may be through our liturgy, that may be through being available to listen to people, counselling and spiritual direction. Giving people an experience of silence, I think, is really important in today's world, particularly the students that I meet. They have iPods, they have mobile phones, they're on the internet constantly, they get goodness knows how many TV channels. Just being still and silent is often very difficult for them. And I think it's an area where Carmelites can share some experience. And preaching and sharing the scriptures, particularly Lectio Divina, which is the Latin for holy reading. It's a way of taking the Bible or even taking the newspapers and reading it in a reflective way, trying to see where God is at work in our world. We're involved in Britain with various justice and peace initiatives. This is me with my face painted blue, and we had a climate change demonstration. It did wash off, thank goodness. We have a United Nations NGO, non-governmental organisation, lobbying at the United Nations on justice issues and informing the rest of the order about international development issues. We have outreach ministries in Britain to those on the margins. So some of our friars are involved with outreach to the lesbian and gay community in Britain, and we have some who are working with the homeless. And interfaith dialogue and ecumenism is really growing in our province. We're only a small island, so you can't go far before you bump into someone of a different belief, different background. Here we have a group of Carmelites meeting with a rabbi who was telling us about Elijah in Judaism today. Rowan Williams meeting the Pope. Well, Rowan Williams has written a great book on Teresa of Avila. He's just stepping down at the end of this year as Archbishop of Canterbury, and he's hopefully going to do some work with the Carmelites on various projects. And this is a visit that myself and a number of Carmelites made to York Mosque recently. So trying to build peace and dialogue through encounter and sharing. And then finally, Carmelites are in ministry in any way that, that lay Carmelites are living. So my mother, she's a mother and grandmother, that's part of her ministry as a Carmelite. Raising families, promoting the gospel in workplaces, and so on. I've tried to give you Carmel in a nutshell. There's so much more that can be said, and there's more sources of information available to you. You've got the centre here, you've got the library, you've got various Carmelite communities that you can talk to if you want to know more. You've got websites. This is our British province website, carmelite.org, and carmelites.org.au is the local province website. And there are three articles that I'd recommend if you're into reading. They're not very long. Jack Welch's The Carmelite Tradition that I quoted from earlier. And then two texts. I have a copy of each of them here. They're available on our website at carmelite.org/spirituality. And they go into some of the different themes that I've not really had time to touch on, but I'm just going to flag them up to you. Father John Marley, who sadly died earlier this year, he was our prior general. He wrote an article on the values and fundamentals of living the Carmelite way, and he emphasises 10 points in Carmelite spirituality. The presence of God, an allegiance to Jesus Christ, the dignity of the human person, the journey of faith, the primacy of love, the importance of prayer, the significance of community, a commitment to service, the beauty of creation, and the need for balance. Father Pat McMahon, who's also an American Carmelite, he has 9 themes. And he highlights that Carmel is Christocentric, focused on Jesus, Eucharistic, scriptural, in harmony with the teaching office of the Pope and the bishops. It's in the classic Catholic tradition. It's Marian, Elijah, it's about community, and it has its roots in the laity. So those are other aspects that you could emphasise, and they're really interesting articles. If you don't have internet access, perhaps I can leave these with Irene and Damien, and maybe you can make copies. So, I've highlighted what I think is important. A lot of it overlaps with this, but there are other things that different people would emphasise. Explore. If it's touched you, if it's inspired you, then there's lots of ways you can find out a bit more. So I think we'll break for coffee, and then maybe gather back here. Is that the plan?
Sure.
Yeah. And we can have a little sharing. If you have experience of Carmelite spirituality, what themes would you emphasise? I asked you to start by saying what word would epitomise Carmel for you. And if it's new to you, if you don't know much about Carmelites, is there anything I've said or that people have shared that has struck you? And we can share that for a few minutes after tea and coffee. If I could make a little appeal, you'll have heard that I like talking. And over the next 2 weeks, I've already visited various communities and talked to them. And I'm going to be talking to, I think, another 10, 15 communities. By the end of November, I will have no voice left, which is probably a good thing because it will give people a chance to rest their ears. But it means I'm going to be able to practice this Carmelite thing of silence. And on the 29th of November, which is the day after I get back from Australia, back to the UK, I'm having a day of not answering the phone, not talking to anybody, and resting my voice in everybody else's ears. And I'm doing that to raise money for a charity called HCPT, which is the Handicapped Children's Pilgrimage Trust. Every year I go to Lourdes. Great privilege to be able to go to Lourdes. I was there earlier this year with Charles. And we take sick and handicapped children every year on pilgrimage for a spiritual time and a holiday time, and it's a rest for their parents. So because I'm a mendicant, I'm begging. I have some flyers here. If you have a credit card and money that you don't know what to do with, there's some of these flyers on the table. And if you could sponsor me to shut up for a day, then it would really make a difference to some needy kids. So I will leave those on the table.
Excellent.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
So let's just have a 10-minute break if you'd like to have a tea or a coffee, and then we'll come back and share something before we finish. Thank you.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you. Come and grab a seat. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. Yeah. that is quiet. Let me know. I'll hand back over to Caroline. Thank you.
Thank you. Hopefully the caffeine has helped. That's a key aspect of my spirituality, caffeine. Someone was asking me over tea and coffee what the difference is between the religious orders, which I should have mentioned. The way I see it is the different religious congregations in the church, it's like a group of builders. If you gave one group of builder stone, wood, glass, and the same materials to another group of builders, and the same to a third group of builders, and said, go away and build me a house, they'd all be using the same basic building blocks, but they'd arrange their house slightly differently. So someone do a bungalow, someone do a skyscraper, you know, whatever it may be. And I think essentially that's true of Carmel. We have these building blocks of prayer, community, and service. So do all the other religious orders. It's just we arrange it in a particular way that suits our house. And I suppose in our house, we make a particular space for Mary and Elijah. And that space, that contemplative openness, is important. So having got that out of my system, are there any questions or comments or thoughts anyone would like to share?
You ask if you have experience of Carmelite spirituality, what key themes would you emphasize? I think the first characteristic, if you like, that struck me when I first came in contact with the Carmelites 23 years ago was gentleness. The second one was realism. They're very realistic. You are where you are. And I remember one of them saying, well, you've got to start where you are, not where you think you are. And I thought that was jolly sensible. So there's a real, you know, realistic and an openness, an accepting of all types. And I noticed in the ministries that you talked about that you're involved with, in York, you know, the ministry of all these various groups, and particularly faith, very important. So I would say gentleness, also extremely welcoming, realistic are two things that stuck out for me. And then there are many, many other things that have grown onto that. It was a gentleness. And I think one of the popes said that Carmel is the prayer of Carmel is like a constantly ever fresh mountain stream. And I found that.
Thank you. I think gentleness and reality, realism, are what drew me to Carmel. I went to university at 18 in York, having grown up near Cambridge. Further south, and I met Carmelite friars and nuns and sisters all in the same small city, which is quite unusual, and I was struck by their kindness, and their humanity and their warmth, and I didn't have to be religious. I thought I had to, I think till then at church I had to perform religiously, and I remember once going out to a pub with Carmelite friars, which is quite a common thing. And there were some pictures on the wall of prints of flowers. And thinking I had to be religious because I was with religious people, I said, oh, it's like the Stations of the Cross in flowers. One of the friars put his point out and said, stop talking about bloody religion. And that dose of realism, done with kindness, I have to say, I think is what I needed, because I had so many doubts and questions about myself, about what I thought, about who I was, as 18-year-olds do, and older people often still do. And the Carmelites gave me that permission to explore, to doubt, to question, to commit. And gentleness is very much the way, it's the little way of Therese, little things. It's the coming to God, not through the great heroic acts often, but the small act of love. Even when you get them wrong, but done out of love. That's what we need in the church, I think. There's, you know, I've been following the press here and all this stuff about abuse at the moment in the church. There's a lot of anger around. And I don't see much gentleness either from the media or government, or indeed some sections of the church. It's very aggressive. And I think Carmel offers a different, gentle realism. Mm. Anybody else? I thought you can all go home.
It just come to my mind about the hunger for God, the hunger that in our heart. What I like in this is that this is mentioned, and I think that nowadays our world, people hunger. We don't know what we are hungry for and how to fulfill it. And I thought this is if this we can help people to come and see that what's in my heart. I really hunger. But this is what I like about how we go about. We have everything we need here. It's not like something little country, we don't have enough food to eat. We hunger first of food, material food. But here, our society, in many developed countries, people hunger, but they don't know that they hunger. And they don't know that what really we feel that hunger. This is what I like, that this is what we need to know.
I think that's right. And I mean, there are places, obviously, where people are hungering for the basic necessities of life. But I think in Australia, in Britain, in the economically developed world, we've become so successful, so rich, so affluent, we're embarrassed to say there's something missing. An emptiness, a hunger that is in here. And when I say we fill it with other things, I include myself. I fill that emptiness with too much pasta, particularly for me. It's great that in Carmel we have a vocabulary of neediness and of emptiness, and saying there is this space in us that only God can fill. And we have a particular term in Carmelite spiritually, vocare Deo, space for God. We have a God-shaped hole, and only God is going to be enough. And our society doesn't like hearing that, because if you spend more, you'll be okay, or if you achieve more, you'll be okay, or if you have a bigger house, you'll be okay. And that's not true. Only God is enough. Solo Dios basta, Teresa of Avila said. Only God is enough. So yes, I think, and that's why in the church, I think there's a real place for Carmel, because so often our church life gets drowned in kind of the business of doing religion, and actually the spirituality that underpins it often gets overlooked, and Carmel is able to respond to that. It's interesting that the average life of a religious order in the church is 200 years, often for a specific role, to set up a hospital or a school or whatever. And then they die out, often when the state kind of is developed to a point that it takes on those things. The Carmelites have been around for 800 years. And I think that's only possible because we have something to say in every age. And I think it's this responsiveness to a very basic human feeling, which is the hunger for God. And we respond differently in each age. We read the signs of the times, and we readapt, and we repackage, and we rethink. But God seems to have a use for us 800 years down the line. And other traditions too, Dominicans and so on. But it's a very rich tradition, and I'm so grateful I found it. Because it gave me a welcome at a time when I was tempted to walk away from the church. When the church that I'd grown up with wasn't really meeting that hunger, and just seemed to me to be a distraction from what really mattered. And Carmel gets you back to the basics. At its best.
In practical terms for the late Carmelite, how is your life organised in on a sort of daily sort of thing? What do you actually do that's...
It's different.
It's different.
Yeah, it varies from person to person. I'm unusual in that I work for the order, so I'm employed. but my mother isn't. You know, she's a retired teacher. What I think we would say is, it's not a question of doing things, it's a question of how we are, it's a question of attitude. But from that, certain things are recommended. So, to follow the rule in as much as it applies to us, the rule of St. Albert. So, regular participation in the prayer life of the church, the Eucharist, and the liturgy of the hours, the office.
Sorry, would you be doing it at home on your own?
Yeah. So, morning prayer, evening prayer.
Okay.
Some people do that strictly with the book. Mm-hmm. Some people find other ways to do it. I'm not very good in the mornings. It takes me 5 cups of tea before I'm functioning. So I normally sit on the side of the bed and I go, God help me. And say the Our Father, and that's my morning prayer normally. Here they have, I've discovered silent prayer with the Friars, and then morning prayer, and that's a good discipline too, but I don't have that discipline at home. Because other people are doing it, I'm doing it. And I'm getting up with enough time to get 5 cups of tea in beforehand. But at home, I adapt. We're encouraged to reflect on the Carmelite tradition, read the Carmelite saints, particularly the scriptures. A Carmelite friar said to me some years ago, and it haunts me every day, a Carmelite should have some contact with the Word of God every day. Now that may mean going to Mass and listening to the scriptures. It may mean sitting with the Bible in front of you. It may mean pondering a particular favourite verse of scripture, whatever it may be. But each day, a Carmelite, whether you're a friar or a lay Carmelite or a nun, is meant to ponder the law of the Lord day and night. So to reflect on scripture, there's another part of the rule that says, let everything you do have God's word for accompaniment. And that's tricky. I'm still trying to build that into my own life more effectively. We're supposed to have some time in silence, so I have a little discipline when I get in from home, or getting to home from work. I used to turn on the telly, check the email, listen to the voicemail, you know, all those. I try now to spend just 5-10 minutes in silence, just to be. And then, I suppose, the justice and peace element, we're encouraged to get involved with practical service of people, whatever that may be. So for my mum, that's often babysitting the grandkids, or looking after a neighbour, or, I don't know, writing a petition in support of environmental campaigns, or you know, whatever it may be. So it's more an attitude of being than of doing, and each person has to work out what to do. We're about to have a gathering of lay Carmelites where we'll be looking precisely at how do lay Carmelite communities across different parts of Australia form a community when people's resources are very different. There are some younger people, some older people. There is no one model. So it's quite flexible. For some people that's frustrating because it's easier if there's just a list of things to do. Mm-hmm. But I'd say for us, we have to try and look at the tradition, what is recommended, the silence, the scripture, the prayer, the community, the service, and work out how to build that into it. Keith, does that sound something like your life?
Well, I find that I come up against the same questions as quite obviously a lot of us do. But then periodically I say, I'll let go and let God, sort of thing, you know. Mm. Because you just come to a spot where you can't do anything else other than just sit. Mm. And I think that's therapeutic, physically, spiritually, in any other way.
Yeah. 50 years ago we would have said you have to say the rosary and you have to go to Mass every day. That was kind of the...
That's the sort of thing I was wondering, you know.
I'd say, there's nothing wrong with either of those things at all. Daily Eucharist would be, I'd say, fairly common amongst lay Carmelites. Mm-hmm. But the rule says daily Eucharist when possible, so we don't have to, travel the country to get to Mass.
Yeah, there's no word like obligation in the rule, is there? There's encouragement and certain things are offered as an encouragement.
Yeah.
and leave it up to the individual.
An Irish Carmelite in the 20th century said, Carmel is the least regimented of the orders. And I think that's probably true. Which some people think is wishy-washy. They like more structure. I like it precisely because it's flexible. And it means so many people can be included. Someone mentioned inclusivity and welcome. I can be a Carmelite. Jim and Martino can be a Carmelite. Many of us here can be Carmelite. Some of us will be very publicly professing that through a religious profession or lay profession in the church, publicly saying, I want to live in this way. But there are many people I know who live Carmelite spirituality without making any sort of formal commitment to the order in that sense. And what really matters is living the life, however that may be.
Thank you, Joanne, for the metaphor of the sunglasses. I found that very helpful. Thank you.
I'm sure there must be a metaphor I can bring in with sun cream, but I haven't worked it out yet.
Would you talk to us about the course that you, I think, are central to in the international?
Sure. Some years ago, we looked in the order at ways that we could share this very rich tradition, this very diverse spirituality around the world, because we're getting lots of inquiries from lay people particularly, who can't go and live necessarily in a community or give up their jobs and their families to go and have formation kind of intensively in the way that a friar or a nun would. And so we set up the Carmelite Institute of Britain and Ireland. It's called that because those were the sponsoring provinces that established it, but actually we now have students from around the world. And we run online courses, little lectures that you download from the internet, on the Carmelite charism, history, the different saints and what they teach us, different aspects of Carmelite life today, justice and peace, popular devotions, you know, whatever it may be, there's many different courses at different levels, from the introductory for people who maybe haven't been studying for a long time or who know nothing about the Carmelites, right up to postgraduate master's level. And you can talk to Irene and Damien about that or to me afterwards. We've now got, I think, 140 students around the world, friars, nuns, lay people, who are studying the spirituality. And because it's online, it's particularly good for the nuns because they don't go out much. You know, they're enclosed, so the internet's ideal. But also for many people, it's more convenient than having to go to a particular location. The challenge with that always is having the resources. You're very lucky here to have such a great Carmelite library. Many people don't have such a resource on their doorstep, so we're trying to build up some of the stuff we have online, more articles, more books. But it's one way of getting to know more about Carmelite.
I'm just interested in the analogy of Carmel being a garden, an orchard. Can you tell me more?
It's a fertile image. I often say, as I did in the PowerPoint, it's a garden between the desert and the sea. And desert is another whole image that I haven't really had time to go into. But I think the Carmelite project is to tend the desert of your life and make it bear fruit. There's all sorts of biblical images of that. And one thing that I think we're really lucky with hindsight within Carmelite spirituality is that we got kicked out of our home very early. We're not linked to one place anymore. Mount Carmel's still important for us as a place. There is now a Carmelite community back there again. But having had to leave our spiritual home, Carmel had to go from being a place to a space in the heart. And so that garden, which is also a desert, I mean, we talk about Carmel as a mountain, as a desert, as a garden, all these different images, that's something that we cultivate inside us. And I suppose, the Bible begins with a garden. It's a place of encounter with God. It's a place of meeting God in your nakedness or covering up. I mean, there's all sorts of stuff you could say about gardens. And as I say, the word Carmel can mean a garden, an orchard, or a vineyard. I like vineyard. It seems that some of the hermits on Mount Carmel were producing wine to sell to the pilgrims who were going past.
And we're going to be using images of wine when we gather in Mittagong, the Lake Carmelites, this coming weekend, because again, there are so many images.
But also the mountain, the garden, you know, the desert. There are also symbolic, if you like, images of the journey that we're all on. Because variously we're in the desert, which has lots of different meanings to us at different times of our lives. Climbing the mountain forever, and when we get to the top of it, there's another 20, and so on. And in the garden, sometimes it's just lovely to be aware of the goodness of God and the creation.
And the garden was an image that was particularly important to St. Therese. She talks about being a little flower in God's garden, how she realized that not everyone could be a great rose or a lily, that you also needed the little daisies, because without the daisies, the lilies and the roses wouldn't stand out. But that God loved the daisies as much as anything else. And yeah, I mean, there's whole books on desert spirituality, and I think that idea of being between the desert and the sea really appeals to me in ways that I'm still thinking through myself. And interesting how many Carmelite communities are by the sea here. We're very near the sea. And most of the early foundations of the order in Europe were by the sea. And one of the earliest titles that we have for Mary was the Star of the Sea. That's how one of our great Carmelite hymns ends, Mary, Star of the Sea. And I suppose, again, that idea of journey. The sea is a place that can kill you or give you life, depending on what you're, you know, are you looking for food or are you looking to have a drink? Yeah. I don't know if that helps at all. But
that's fantastic. His seven stone mountain says it all, doesn't it?
Yeah, there's so much in Merton. And he was steeped in Carmelite spirituality. I like the mountain image because, like we had on the Carmelite pilgrimage walk at the weekend, that, you know, there are bits that go up, sometimes very steeply, sometimes not, sometimes it's smooth, sometimes you're with other people on the journey, sometimes you're on your own. That mountain image is very, very powerful as a metaphor. Again, Therese bypasses all of that. She talks about ascending to God, and she says, no, that's too much work. I'm going to let God lift me up. He's going to do the carrying up the mountain, which is typically Therese. She knows people in high places and gets shortcuts.
I find it very difficult to see how what you've been talking about would appeal to the two or three generations of youth and of people who are very young and people who are old, who seem to be lost to the church.
It's a challenge, and it's a challenge, and I don't have an easy answer to that. I think where it does appeal, when I talk to my friends and they say, well, what on earth do you do? They don't really understand what I do. I think they appreciate the spirituality. They appreciate the poetry of Carmel. And I sometimes sit with them with writings of John of the Cross, which is love poetry, basically. Nothing overtly religious about it at all. And I think they're very sceptical of organised religion, sceptical of church and the structures around church, but most of them are receptive to spirituality, to relationship, to a relationship with God and with other people. And I think it's interesting, we have a Carmelite spirituality group meets in York once a month, and we have some people who come to that who don't go to any other sort of church. It is for them their experience of church, because I think we can have a conversation about what really matters, the hungers in our heart, the desire for God, in ways that don't threaten, they feel threatened, I think, often by church, or just put off. And that is a problem. It's a problem of how do we communicate then with people who really don't have an interest. I think basically people are good-hearted, basically. I think people are good. And
if they don't go to church, but they're loving, it's better than nothing. And if Carmel helps them through the poetry, through the art, through the spirituality, as it seems to, then you know, it may lead on to a more church life. But I think church, church is family, it's God's family. So I know from my family, there are some members of my family I'm in contact with very regularly, and some not for months on end, but I know they're all family. We love each other and care for each other, and we just have to hold those people, often at the edges, but we still hold them.
Where else? One more question before we...
Where else in the world do you have wellness centres, Carmelite centres like this one?
I make it my mission to find out. We have a spirituality centre in Aylesford, which is in southern England, where I am quite regularly. We would have centres in Italy, Spain, Ireland, that I know of, United States, really around the world.
The
Philippines,
Indonesia,
Timor, Peru, Argentina, Brazil. Where more or less wherever you find Carmelites, you'll find some sort of centre like this, or community like this anyway. Here I think you're particularly well set up with facilities and so on, but you'll find something like this going on pretty much anywhere there are Carmelites. But as I say, I'm just beginning my international travels. Next summer, that's my summer, July, your winter, I'm going to Africa for the first time to meet with the Carmelite Friars in Cameroon and to do some formation with them. So I hope to discover that they have something similar, and if not, then I'm sure they will. So yeah, one of the things I love about Carmel is it's like an international hotel chain. You could go and meet family around the world. And I love the fact that I can go into the church here or the priory or meet with the nuns or the lay Carmelites, and we have a shared vocabulary, imagery. I know what the statue is of the man brandishing his sword on fire, and I know who the woman is holding one of these cloths and that sort of thing. And singing the same hymns and speaking the same language and resonating. An image that a Carmelite friar introduced me to very early on in my Carmelite life was, you resonate with other Carmelites. You know, with a tuning fork, you hit it and it kind of vibrates at a certain pitch. And when you get two that vibrate at the same pitch, it kind of magnifies the sound. And you get that with Carmelites. You kind of strike a chord. Doesn't mean you always get on with them. We're not all friends. We try. But personalities sometimes clash, but we still resonate. And we still have that homeliness. We built our houses in that particular way, and we welcome each other into our houses ourselves.
Johan, you have entitled your talk, How to Summarize Carmel in a Nutshell. Well, I think you've broken the nutshell for us. For those of you who have further interest, here's this book called Climbing the Mountain, which has been edited by Johan. I would really draw your attention to that. How do you say thank you to someone who has such passion and love for Carmel? You were saying before that you were grateful for finding the Carmelites. We're very grateful, Johan, for you, for your scholarship, your learning. But what I sensed tonight was your passion. And I think if there's something that is needed today, it's passion and love for God. You marvellously demonstrate that. And on behalf of you tonight, I simply want to thank you very much. I'm sure you get some questions after this. But look, I'd like to thank you very much for your presentation tonight.
Where can you buy that book?
That's the
most important
question.
When you came in on the registration sheet,
yes.
If you would like to put against your name,
yes.
Climbing the Mountain,
yes.
I'll follow you up with
yes.
a place
okay.
where you can buy the book.
Thank you.
I've asked Johan if he's prepared to share the PowerPoint, and in typical graciousness, the answer was yes. So if I've got your email and you're on the list, I'll send you the PowerPoint. But what you need to make sure is that I've got your email if you're not already on our mailing list. And the other thing that I'll send to you is the articles that that Johan referred to from the website, I'll actually download those and send them to you as attachments, and you can print them. So, but about the climbing the mountain,
yes,
the book, a few people have asked about that, so just put near your name, or even if you just put book, and I'll follow it up. Okay.
In winding up, I'd like to not only welcome our regulars, but also to welcome those who've travelled a long way to be here this evening. What does that suggest? It suggests an interest, not only in things Carmel, but ultimately in the mystery of God and God's love and God's call, which takes place in His time and His readiness. Our part is to respond to that, as in the words of John and Johan remind us, not where there is no love, put love, and we'll find love. So I particularly want to welcome those people here who are new tonight, as well as our regulars. We are Carmel. We manifest all that Johan has so glowingly presented tonight. So let us go out and be a sign of that love in our workplaces, to our friends, down the pub, wherever we can be, and so that our hearts do burn with us. Have a safe trip back tonight. We have your emails. We will be in contact with you. And
There is no escape. You're not escaping.
So on that note of no escape, again, I'd like to thank you for coming. Thanks again, Johan.